Welcome to yet another edition of Paradigm Shift, an educational comedy. The title is PSEC 2015.
I didn't learn with COMMUN COAR.
And it's about how our current system of indoctrination, which is laughably referred to as education, has narrowed the minds of the masses. So we're going to be talking about that.
Indeed.
How it's been making everybody butthurt. Like, you know, gay marriage legalized. Oh my god, yeah! Charlatan shooting, frickin' everyone's getting all hot and bothered about the Confederate flag and shit.
Let the butthurt flow through you.
So, you know, I mean, there's all, it's a result of the educational system. This indoctrination system. We emotionally react, we get all butthurt, and anybody who isn't getting butthurt with us, so they're the enemy, blah blah. But I've loved how many people seem to be waking up and looking at the butthurt people and going, oh, calm down. You know, just like, why are you getting all upset about this shit, about a flag, about, you know, and just calling them on their Nazism. And I mean, you know, literally, our educational system was designed by Nazis to make us all think like Nazis and act like Nazis. And, you know, that's history. That's recorded, documented history. So if anybody doesn't like what I'm saying about that, you know, they can go argue with the historians and go try to claim that historical things that happened are wrong just because they're butthurt and they don't like it and whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Just like people are like, you don't like Obama, you're racist and you're anti-Semitic. Fuck you, and you're the devil. And you know, I'm just like, okay, I respect your right to, you know, act like that, whatever. But, you know, we got to kind of call the elephant in the room. And we are here with Katerina Edwards Roy, whatever you want to call her, whatever. And we're also technically here with Richard Hamilton, but he went off to do something or another, and we're not exactly sure when he's going to return. Should be shortly. So, yes, Katerina and Rich are here in theory. Oh, here's Rich.
And Katerina.
Yay, Rich is back. Well, I know you're here. I just said that, but Rich just returned. So now he's finally back. And I was just mentioning how the educational system that was literally based on Nazism and designed that way has taught us all to think like Nazis and act like Nazis. So all of a sudden something happens in Charlatan and people are getting all butthurt about a flag. It's like, they don't know anything about the history of that flag. They're just following.
This flag means we want to burn some niggers. I'm going to drink me some moonshine because I'm a southerner.
No.
They're just following the race baiting from the Obama administration because that administration wants a race war.
I see more blacks walking around in this country going, I'm going to kill me some white people. I got my 380 Saturday night special. Look out, motherfucker. Bang, bang. You know, than I do seeing rednecks walking around going, yeah, them niggers better look out because we're going to go hunt them and lynch them from trees. And I'm a redneck and I can say that.
So, hey, guys.
Shame.
Me actually understanding what the fuck it is you guys are talking about. What the fuck are you talking about? Because you guys didn't tell me what it is that we were going to be talking about on this thing before.
Oh.
Actually, I kind of did, and I was just speaking about the introduction of it, and not my fault if you weren't listening. I will restate it again. Today's episodes, for everybody who didn't catch it the first 10 times, PSEC 2015.
I learned more with COMMUN COAR.
Yeah,
how our current system of indoctrination, which is laughably referred to as education, has narrowed the minds of the masses.
Hey, Dave, why are you so up in arms about the education system in America? Like, why is that the particular thing that you always are, like, dissing on? Or rather, illuminating people about?
Well, when you look at how we are trained by society to act, and you look at the way people act, instead of pointing the finger of blame at different groups and whatever, oh, that person shouldn't be acting that way, blah, 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 isn't it better to get more to the root of things? Like, you know, The tree branch isn't hovering in the air independently. It's connected to a trunk, which is connected to a root system. The root system is the base. So what is the root system of the society? The educational system. Kids weren't, you know, they didn't jump out of the womb when they were born going, hell yeah, I know everything. Woohoo, it's cold in here. Get me a towel, you know. I mean, how did they learn what they know? And what is the human body and the human brain hardwired to do? It's not hardwired towards good or evil. It's hardwired to survive through adaptation to its environment by emulation. So if a kid is raised in a malevolent environment, then they're going to emulate that in order to survive. Because, you know, if you got a bunch of people going, I'm going to kill you, motherfucker, and they got their guns, obviously going, hey, let's all just have a big group hug is not going to stop them from shooting you. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you learn to emulate and adapt to your environment. So obviously if a child is raised in a benevolent environment, then they're going to learn things like critical thinking and respect and so on and so forth. And Hitler said it himself. He said the beautiful thing about the totalitarian state is that it forces those who fear it to emulate it. He's right. He's a bastard, but he's not wrong. That's exactly how he took over Germany.
So where is the fun in talking about this? I want to have fun talking about this. I'm not going to have fun, and I'm not going to be here.
You make fun of it like we were just doing.
Exactly.
You just got to make fun of people. Oh. And another thing, there was a my history teacher, not going to say her name publicly, but got into a little chat with her on Facebook about, you know, the education system. She posted this petition to ban the Confederate flag, which is a crock of shit. That's against the First Amendment. That's against what the United States, this republic, stands for. But anyway, you know, I posted, me and Dave essentially wrote it up, but, you know, I posted it, you know, just because I wanted to say something to her that was true, you know, that was based on history. You could look it up, you know, it's there. And, you know, I've said things that have, you know, basically made her feel like the village idiot before. You know, she's literally said it publicly, you know, that I've made her feel like the village idiot. And nothing bad. She's a very nice person. She's a wonderful lady. You know, she's given back to the community. She's given back to the world. She's done a lot of wonderful things, and she's a good person. But sometimes she can say things that I, in my opinion, are misguided. But, you know, I just kind of called her on it, and I was like, okay, so if the Confederate flag represents genocide and white racism and supremacy, what about the American flag? Didn't that also at one time fly over slaves? Didn't that at one time also fly over Japanese internment camps? Didn't that at one time also, you know, fly over institutionalized hospitals, which were more like prisons where we kept our special needs and, you know, the mentally handicapped and treated them worse than cattle?
Mm-hmm.
That was under the American flag. That was under us. That was under the Northerners.
Hey, guys, and, let's defend everybody at once.
Oh, yes. And, yes.
Sing hell, motherfucker. I'm a gay Southerner.
Confederate flag with rainbow flag, with swastika, with stars of David, with pentagrams. With, yeah, we've got the whole gamut in here.
I see.
Let's offend everyone at once. Sounds like a good idea. Sounds awesomely wonderful, in fact. And as a matter of fact, speaking of just offending everybody, let's put this up too. I got the new flag here. Because the Confederate flag flew over slavery and oppression of blacks, and the American flag flew over the genocide of millions of Native Americans, both have been replaced with a more suitable, updated flag to accommodate everyone who has complained. This new flag also more accurately represents how the U.S. government feels about its citizens. There's Daffy Duck with the middle finger. Fuck you.
Alrighty then.
What, you don't think that's funny? I think it's funny.
Sure.
I What do you think, Rich? I'm actually glad that most people's reactions to this stuff have been just to poke a bit of, you know, a bit of friendly fun and, you know, not get all butthurt and everything. I mean, I'm really glad that people are just, they're seeing all the whining and the crock of shit for what it is, and they're just like, okay, guys, come on. Like, come on.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's getting to a point of just absolute, you know, it's like, and I just posted something not too long ago about Eric Holder, you know, where he's talking about we need to get people to think about guns in a vastly different way, and we need to indoctrinate them on a daily basis. I mean, that was in 1995.
We need to brainwash.
That was over 20 years ago. That was the year I was born. He said that 20 years ago. And, you know, you look at the mainstream media now, like a bunghole up there on his podium, you know, got all the hard wires on his brain, you know, injecting what he needs to say to make the little sheeple feel better about themselves. And I'm just sitting here in the middle. It's like, you know, it's total brainwash is what it is. They're telling one side that these are hateful bigots. They're telling the other side that these are hateful bigots. And then they try to get everybody all worked up in the center. And, you know, now we've got a bunch of oversensitive, spineless turncoats running around nowadays saying that we need to ban this and ban that and ban this over here because it might offend somebody. Well, I'm sorry. Life is about offending people. It happens. It's unavoidable. You know, you go to school, you get offended by something somebody says. It happens. You just got to learn to take it in stride, and you just got to learn to handle it because sometimes people are going to say things you don't particularly like.
Like, look at how I handled my next-door neighbor offense, which I just made a music video, you know, that's what I thought. Got to put the fun back into life, and that's what I see more people doing.
Yeah, exactly.
I see more people making jokes and not getting all angry, you know, at these people for being all butthurt and whatever, and I mean, I really think that it's a very positive thing that more and more people are taking a more calm, logical, and playful and fun approach, you know? Katerina, are you still here?
Yes.
Okay. Just making sure.
Ah!
Don't you think that's a good thing, Katerina? That more people are responding to the butthurt with just being playful and just like, come on, guys, let's have some fun. I think that's a very good thing. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
She's just chilling.
Like a thug.
Thug life.
No, I have this bar stool that my friend made out of pipes of wood, and I'm just playing with it.
Oh, got it.
I'm going like this.
Let me flip your own question back at you. What do you have to say about our current system of brainwashing? A.K.A. education.
Honestly, like, it's not even really much on my radar, considering, like, homeschooling is kind of the premise of where my thought process goes. I guess homeschooling because public school education is retarded. Like you're saying, like, you know, it's pretty inferior. The kids that are raised in it are retarded. Like, it literally do not know how to do things.
I'm not retarded, I'm a common core student. You shut up. I know my teacher. and I can spell cat, K-H-A-T. I'm a common core. You don't even
okay, shut up for a second.
You're racist. You're racist.
My name is William Black, and I'm in love with common core. My friends are G+, are right.
It's that kind of that attitude.
All right, bad attitude in Common Core students. I have something to say. So Paul recently was teaching his entrepreneur school stuff to kids that were like ages 9 through 13, 14, I think, 14. And the kids were actually quite intelligent because they came from like Waldorf schools and home schools. So the kids were actually, like, doing really complicated long division in their head. And, like, Paul had to pull out a calculator. He was like, oh, my God. And he was homeschooled, you know, so he didn't have to deal with the bullshit, like, public school system. But it's just fascinating how the people who are not subjected to public school education typically end up more well-rounded, more intelligent, and better educated and more equipped for life. So,
and people who've been through the public school system are like, you're not agreeing with Obama, so you're racist, and the Confederate flag is racist, and your face is racist. I'm a DMCA, your face offends my copyleft, and fuck you, and I'm a Common Core student, and you can kiss my butt, because I'm right and you're wrong, and shut up.
Common Core, in the way that it's being done right now,
Nazism.
Pretty new. I was not raised with Common Core.
It's actually pretty old, like 19.
Old, but I'm saying what we've done now in the direction of the math that they're being taught now, like, that's pretty new. I'm
there
saying.
There are 98 little fucking circles which have hashy thingies, and if you saw
no,
the.
No. Okay. I dealt with it when they just, because I was graduating the year they were just initiating the math program at my school.
How old are you, Rich?
I am 19. Hard to believe, but yes.
You're 19.
I believe I've told you once, but you've probably forgotten, which is fine.
That's because you look like you're 40. Sorry.
Nah. I've heard most people say I look like I'm 27.
Yeah, 40 is my guess, but that's pretty funny. Oh, you have a shirt that says 2014 senior, I guess.
Uh-huh. Unless I were 40 years old and graduated high school, that would be pretty underachiever, but
yep. Okay.
But anyway,
Kristen's friend Brandy thought that he was 30, so then he scanned his frickin' driver's license to prove his actual age and sent it to Kristen.
And then afterwards, I was like, rejected. And then just kind of walked away to the other side of the room because they didn't know how to handle the playful side of the force. They kind of got all butthurt. Decided to go Emperor Palpatine.
Well, Kristen didn't. I mean, Kristen was cool.
Kristen was fine, yeah. Kristen was just giggling and having a good time, but they were just...
Brandy was kind of like, yeah, and then, like, Lexa, like, you know, like, I made a joke and was just like, I still think Richard thinks you've been drinking Brandy. Because, you know, the one girl's name is Brandy. And, like, Lexa, like, fucking blocks me on her Facebook. I'm like, whatever.
It's that kind of thing. But anyway, it's just being a math student from 2014 high school season, I got a 91 on my college final for math this year, and that's doing just standard math, learning it correctly, having a good teacher there by my side who's been with me since middle school, practically, you know, real mentor. But, you know, with the Common Core system, the way they did it, essentially they were of the presumption that I would never achieve anything with math. They said that it wasn't possible, blah, blah, blah. You know, they were making all these excuses, and I knew they were full of shit. Mm-hmm. But, you know. No, Common Core is not designed to teach you critical thinking. It's designed to make it so tough for people to learn that they just give up and they put all these mental blocks in the way so they just blindly accept authority and whatever anybody says so they don't think for themselves. They want to discourage thinking for yourself. They want to make it seem like it's this impossible mountain to climb over. It's not possible, you know.
Well, that's probably not written in their teacher's manual handbooks. Let's discourage critical thinking.
No, but that's the
unfortunate byproduct. Who knows whether or not that was the actual intention. I mean, we're sounding like conspiracy nutsos right now, but it's like...
Actually, it was the intention, and that's provable. It's an inconvenient fact.
All right, show me the proof, and then I'll believe you. Okay, so my point, though, is that, like, I was a public school student, and when I did college placement tests to get into math, I ended up placing, like, out of calculus 2, you know, because I'm, I guess, a math person. I get it. So it's just interesting for me to hear that there are other people who are exposed to the math system in schools, and then they're not, like, actually learning stuff. Because I was in the same math system, and I understood it, and then again, I also graduated in 2010, so I'm not sure.
Katerina.
What?
Remember what Rich was saying about his unnamed teacher? Mm-hmm. Well, I made a PSEC episode about that and a journal and wrote it down here. It's a rather short one. But in this, it provides the proof because the evidence you seek was provided to that teacher within the reply. And the reply is this. This may not at first seem to have anything to do with the current topic, but it does. Your patience is appreciated. Horace Mann, former U.S. congressman, was instrumental in the creation of the current American educational system. The system was based on the Prussian educational system. In 1837, he became the head of the then newly created Board of Education. His work earned him the title of the Father of American Public Education. His new concept that the state is the father of all children, which is responsible for the education of every child, was a very noble idea. But what exactly did he mean by this? I'll explain. After the Prussians were defeated by Napoleon in 1806, it was decided that the Prussian soldiers were thinking for themselves in the battlefield instead of following orders. To make sure that this couldn't happen again, a new 8-year system of schooling was created. This being our current elementary school system. The system was based on unquestioned obedience to authority. Through this new system, the Prussian system aimed to create social obedience through indoctrination. Every individual had to become convinced at the core of their being that the king was just, his decisions were always right, and the need for obedience paramount. In truth, the entire system was to instill loyalty to the crown and to train young men for the military, bureaucracy, and the workforce. To do this, the elimination of critical thinking from the masses was mandatory. The father of the Prussian system was a man by the name of Johann Gottlieb Fichte. His ideology was that children are a blank slate to be written upon. The system was established as a system that was considered to be scientific in nature. The importance of the system was that it defined for the child what was to be learned, what was to be thought about, and how long to think about it. It was believed that in order for government to rule its people efficiently, the people's ability to make sense out of available information needed to be removed. Critical thinking was an enemy of this new system. The reason that our current system does not openly admit to being based upon the Prussian model is because its original purpose was designed not for the good of the individual, but for the good of the government. Fichte states, "The school must fashion the person and fashion him in such a way that he simply cannot will otherwise than what you wish him to will." With quotes like these, we can see why his involvement is not well known. Fichte continues, "The education should aim at destroying free will so that after the pupils are schooled, they will be incapable throughout the rest of their lives of thinking or acting otherwise than as their schoolmasters would have wished. When this technique has been perfected, every government that has been in charge of education for more than one generation will be able to control its subjects securely with little need of armies or policemen." Johann gave a series of addresses to the German nation which were anti-Semitic and demanded the removal of all Jews from Germany. He spoke about the superiority of the German people above all others. Fichte had a deep influence on the rise of the Third Reich, and the Prussian system was used by Hitler to facilitate his rise to power over people that were already indoctrinated into blind obedience to authority. This is the system we currently use here now in the United States, and Common Core is an extension of that system. So in my opinion, getting rid of a treasonous educational system based on neo-Nazism is more important than an uninformed opinion about a flag, which for Southerners of all creeds and colors stands for Southern pride and not bigotry. How's that for proof for you, Katerina? You know, because if it's not good enough for you, then I guess I'm just going to have to call you a Holocaust denier. Oh, you're one of those people.
You're one of those guys. No, I'm just saying that was really long and monotonous. So I'm like going like... Well, I have ADD, so I'm like... I have no attention span because I'm one of those public school kids that played video games and watched TV before I was 5 years old.
Well, the truth is a bitch, huh?
Look at you chugging your orange juice.
Better than Dr. Pepper, health-wise.
I guess.
Not taste-wise, but health-wise.
Mm-hmm.
So what do you have to say, Katerina? I mean, I know you've just been, like, all owned and everything, but what do you have to say?
I'm not being owned. You have this idea in your mind that I am, like, disagreeing with what you're saying. I'm not. And you're, like, trying to be all smug, like, thug, like, oh. So, step off.
Uh-huh.
You ghetto-ass, like, Chicagoland beaches person.
Now, folks, this is what we refer to as backpedaling when you've been defeated.
No, I'm not backpedaling, honestly. I'm just saying that...
I'm just teasing you, Katerina.
What? You're just teasing me.
I'm just teasing you. Because I'm being a fucking troll.
I know you're trolling. I've been friends with you for like 4 years. I know when you're trolling, you ass.
Hey, I am not a demican, thank you very much.
A demican?
Fucking demicans. It rhymes with demons.
But the Republicrat elephant is in the room.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Two wings, one bird. Let's do the funky chicken. It's called politics. Show business for ugly people.
I have absolutely no faith in either political party. They both suck.
Oh my god, you guys! Like, my political parties suck!
Wine and cheese parties.
Wine and cheese parties, you guys. The United States sucks. Well, why don't you go live abroad? See how much better it is, honestly.
I didn't say that the entire world wasn't locked into the same system.
Well, then how about we get you a rocket and you go to Mars? How about that? I am so tired of listening to people talk about how shitty America is. Go try living in another country for a little while, and you'll gain, like, an iota of appreciation for the ability that you have to sit on your ass and play on the computer at 4 o'clock in the afternoon.
Yep.
Like, literally. Mm-hmm. Shut the fuck up. Stop complaining.
Mm-hmm.
Like, seriously. Yeah,
but the thing is I'm not saying any of that. I'm not complaining.
No, I'm talking to Rich. I'm so tired of hearing people talk about, I have no faith in either public party, blah, 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 blah. I'm just like, I want to rattle the computer. That's why I spend most of my time not on Facebook, because I'm tired of listening to whiny people talk about how much they hate the government and all of that stuff, and yet they're sitting there with their government-subsidized cell phones, and their government-subsidized food stamps, and their government-subsidized housing, and whatever the
I don't have any of that.
Okay, I'm not talking about you in particular, Rich, but I'm just talking about people in general.
I know what you mean. Yeah, I know exactly what you mean. Oh, I hate the government. I got my Obama phone. I got my Obama food stamp. I got my Obama computer. I got my Obama George Foreman grill. I got my Obama jewelry. I got my Obama t-shirt.
I'm masturbating with my Obama vibrator, and it's all big black and titanium.
It drives me crazy. You guys have no idea. You guys have no idea.
In all seriousness, I know exactly where you're coming from. My grandparents were missionaries over in Africa for 30 years. I know what a shit toilet third world country looks like. It's bad. You know, my father went through a horrible experience being locked in prison, and yes, I will still talk about that story as a point of experience because it's affected him to this very day. But he's been at the bottom of that, and, you know, I used to be one of those people that used to, you know, be all pessimistic and, oh, it's coming here, there's nothing stopping it, oh, it's all downhill from here. But, you know, it's the awareness that something bad is happening is the awareness to also at the same time prevent that from happening.
Yeah, and exactly. Because it's like the way I see it, when people are like, you know, when you just try to say, hey, you know, there's a problem, let's fix it, let's, you know, see this negative circumstance as a positive opportunity for positive change, they get all new agey. You're being negative, shut up. I'm tired of hearing people complain about how bad America is and about both political parties. You should just go live abroad, because I'm a new ager. Love and lie.
Okay.
I can't look at the
everything I just said
as a positive opportunity. I can't see it as that. I have to see it as all negative and shun the dark. Love and light, shun the dark. Shun the evils.
Really? Really? You're taking everything I just
love
said.
Love is light and kittens. We need to leap through the rose field.
You are an absolute tool.
Well, you took everything I said and turned it around. I was just returning the favor.
I was not turning
the favor, isn't it? You took everything.
Rich.
You took everything. Made me seem like some conspiracy nut. So I took what you said.
Okay, and we can have a dualistic battle.
I need to put on my tinfoil hat, boy. Right. I live down there in them there southern Oregon. I need to put on my tinfoil hat and stand on the television set to deflect the satellites from the CIA.
Guys, just please. We're talking about Confederate flags.
The space program's a hoax. The moon landing was a fake CIA draconian lizard experiment.
I'm a CIA agent trying to control you, Rich. I'm setting you up to be a shooter at the next bull flag.
Obama is a Martian from the planet Mars. He's in the White House controlling the people. It's an alien conspiracy.
Kumbaya, my lord. Kumbaya.
Smoke the peace pipe.
Here's your peace flower. We're not going to talk about draconians anymore. We're going to just talk about how much we love each other and love the planet. Oh my gosh, it's going to be awesome. Yeah! Woo!
We are the champions. We are the champions.
I'm Jordan the Butthurt, and Teal Swan is MK Ultra and Chief Evil. I don't want to hear anybody else's perspective.
Problems. Hashtag New Ager problems.
Stupid you are. Breed, you should not.
You know, modern America, like, does not know what the fuck MK Ultra is, or a Teal Swan is, or what a Jordan Lavina butthurt is.
I know what MK Ultra is. I've experienced it firsthand.
It's a paradigm shift in educational comedy, so modern America doesn't have to fucking know. Only the audiences that resonate with this get to know.
I know, but I'm just saying how funny it is, how, like, subcultured this conversation is.
You know what's even more ironic?
What?
It's based on knowledge that is so broad, that goes so far back into history, and that's all-encompassing, that it gets the core points of common sense. Like, you know, if the masses let an asshole run things, you're going to have an asshole society. It's like, that's common sense to me. That's not conspiracy theory. That's like, if you let a douchebag run things, you're letting a douchebag run things. Who's the majority? Who's the minority? That's like, it'll be like a football team saying, we can't oppose that scary coach because he's so big and bad. He'll just kick all our asses, even though we're big, strapping football players and can just flatten him in half a second. We're just going to be scared of him because he's so big and bad. And that's what the fucking population does. It's like, really? Did the douchebags say, oh, we got to run, you guys? So the masters are like, okay, well, that's just how it is because we're Common Core students. It's like, you're the fucking masses. If you don't want douchebags in power, stop listening to them. You don't have to storm the fucking White House. Just stop following all the draconian fucking laws. Just be like, nope. I mean, if like 100 million people just peacefully say, nah, we're not doing that, what are a few morons going to do? Cry? What are they going to do if everybody says no? I mean, you know, come on.
Obama, you can have your Obama phone back.
You're saying bank robbers rob banks. That's a conspiracy theory, you nut.
You are a nut, Dave.
You're a fringe moron. Bank robbers don't rob banks. They hold up sunflowers.
Me too, Dave.
They're all joy and love in the banks. They're not. By robbing, they mean robbing the bank of the negativity by injecting their positivity. They don't steal money from banks. That's not what bank robbers do. You're a conspiracy nut, God. Thinking bank robbers steal money from banks.
Conspiracy nut.
You're stupid.
You're stupid. This is stupid.
Rich's connection dropped, I think, but he'll be right back.
Okay, well,
I think his modem died again.
Intermission. I need lemonade and pizza.
We interrupt this broadcast for lemonade and pizza intermission. And Richard Hamilton has returned.
That was weird.
Please hold while Katerina gets lemonade and pizza.
Oh, lucky. Frickin' Texans. Everything's bigger in Texas.
I manifested 2 free pizzas last night.
Including Katerina's boobs.
What? My boobs are free?
No, Rich said everything's bigger in Texas. I said including Katerina's boobs.
Size D, bitches.
I knew it. Nope, jokes.
D for dystopian government.
That's a conspiracy theory. I'm wearing black, and my friends on G+ say you have a mental disorder. Shut up.
Bank robbers don't rob banks. You conspiracy nut.
Who has a mental disorder?
By robbing, they mean they're robbing the bank of the negativity and spreading joy.
You're talking about G+.
Bank robbers don't steal.
Oh, I'm talking about William Black. Yeah. He's been crouching around lately.
Yeah, this is William Black, and I want to have a dialogue.
I want to have a dialogue with your rectum. Give me a call.
I want to stalk you and leave creepy messages on your voice. Yeah. That's what we're making fun of. That's what he did. Like, we invited him on a Google Hangout. He was saying all sorts of shit against us, and we're like, come on, we'll shut up and we'll let you say whatever you want to say.
I don't know who William Black is.
You know, we're telling you. Show your face, speak your voice, and you can say whatever. And instead, because this guy lives in the Chicago area, apparently, although he's originally from somewhere east, you can tell by his accent, you know. But this guy, he finds my number and he calls me. He's like, yeah, Dave Kelso, this is William Black. And it's like, oh God, what a fucking creeper. But yeah, he was just harassing Rich's DeviantArt group, and he was primarily targeting me and Rich because he was trying to create pandemonium between the admins of his group so that the group collapses. But instead, we just laughed at him and said, okay, you have the right to think what you think. How about you come on, hang out and say it? And he, like, would not even acknowledge that we're making the offer. Instead, he looks up my fucking number, stalks it down somehow, calls me, gets this creepy voicemail. Dude, Kelso, this is William Black. I heard you want to have a dialogue. Give me a call, 1-900-TINY-PENIS. You know, it's just like, what? And the number on the call ID was 312, so, you know, that's Chicago area code. So, yeah, like, douchebag does live in my city. But it's so funny, just, you know, give someone the right to hate you, and what happens? They look up your number and leave a creepy voicemail. Like, you won't even dialogue. Like, okay. I heard you need medication. Yeah. So yeah, just a creepy guy. Oh, I was going to say, were you trying to enable that infinite tunnel of...
Look at this. That's a person.
That's
a hand. That's a body, her leg, her head. Isn't that trippy?
Crazy.
And this one.
Oh, yeah, the body art where they pose like animals.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I've seen that. That stuff's cool.
Look, the giraffe.
Yeah, that frog is like two people.
Mm-hmm. Whoa.
Spider.
Those are boobs. Yeah. And a snake. Hmm. Oh, that's the head right there. Arm, back, butt. That's so cool. DVD moment, guys. That's awesome. Okay. And now, back to your regular scheduled program.
Yes. That was our commercial break of shiny things. Carving cards didn't want shiny things. Anyway, Richard, I know there were some things you wanted to talk about on this.
Oh, man. On what particular topic? My brain has kind of gone dead because we were talking about everything that's happened in the last 6 months. We've gone off on the Confederate flag spiel. What was the other thing? Mine's drawn a blank. That's bad. Not good.
I have to leave names out and stuff, but I could talk about some amusement that happened on Kristen's Facebook profile and not too.
Oh, yeah.
There was this guy who made this comedy video about religion. Your religion might be bullshit if, and you know. It was all just funny. Like, they got everything. They got Christianity, Scientology, Mormons, Islam, just everything, the whole gamut. And obviously, it was just made to be silly and whatever. And, you know, I shared that over to Kristen's timeline. And then someone on her timeline, I won't mention who, I'll just say that it's one of those fundamentalist anal people that, you know, they believe in fire, brimstone, hell, and Satan, and that's their literally shit. But they pretend they believe in love and Jesus and so on and so forth when really we see who their actual master is. And she's tried to mess with me before, and I was just like, look, I just called her on it straight, you know, just straight up, called her on her bullshit. Then she got all pissed off. You're a creep and you're a pedophile and I'm calling the cops on you and you're a criminal and just like spouting all this crazy shit. And I'm like, what? I'm like, okay, well, at least I know who to sue if the authorities end up at my door. And then she's like, you're avoiding my critical thinking questioning. I'm like, no, you're slandering me as a means of avoiding my critical thinking questioning because I was questioning the dogma of the church and you got all freaking butthurt. And then my dad jumps on and he was freaking hilarious. And Rich jumps in and he's like, what does God mean with a starship? And my dad's like, he needs it to send the bitch back to ISIS. That's why he needs it, you know. So it just... It got really just freaking hilarious and crazy, and it ended up very quickly, like, settling down. But, I mean, I respected this person's right to, you know, talk their shit. I'm just like, whatever, you know. I'm just like, you know, you're one of the scribes, false prophets, Pharisees that Jesus talked about, you know, as far as the organized religion stuff. And, yeah, you know, I was just like, you minion of Satan. Yeah. It was hilarious. And this person, it's funny, they ended up blocking me. They didn't block Rich. They didn't block my dad. Like, my dad was calling her a cunt and posting all these crazy pictures in the thing, you know, in the comments and stuff. I don't really, you know, agree with his methods, but I do think it was funny. And it's even more funny that she didn't block him. She blocked me. I'm the only one that she blocked. And all I did was question the church, the organized church, and say, hey, you know, you guys have an interpretation of Scripture. You guys, you know, don't have the absolute rule on it. And I even stated that in the not-too-distant past, the Catholics said that Catholicism is the only one true religion, and the Lutherans responded with, the Pope is the office of the Antichrist. So, you know, there's a little bit of back and forth even, you know, between Christian denominations and shit. And I just thought the whole thing was freaking hilarious. And Kristen was just like, hey, you know, you attack people, you're gonna get responded to. Don't expect there to be no consequences when you start threatening and slandering people. So yeah, it all quieted down, and, you know, nobody really gave Kristen any shit about it because Kristen was being completely logical, and, you know, most people could see the validity of the points. So I just thought that was just really freaking hilarious, and I think it was just a really good opportunity for Kristen to stand in her sovereignty, because this had been a person that had successfully intimidated her a lot in the past, and now she was able to stand up to her in a very polite and reasonable way, and to stand in her sovereignty, and she saw that she was able to do it, so that was cool. So anybody have anything else to say?
No, I'm thinking about gay pride, because I'm looking at some of my friends, because I have a lot of different people on my newsfeed. I have very staunch liberals, and very very conservative Christians. I have the full gamut.
I think the idea of whether or not gay marriage can be legal is like a marital status of the number five sort of question. I think that the state should just butt out of people's fucking business, because their people's relationship statuses with each other is not the state's business. So the state shouldn't get involved at all in any capacity, period.
I'm reading one of these from one of my Christian missionary friends in Costa Rica. Mm. They say, same-sex marriage is now legal and recognized in 100% of the USA. But before you rejoice too much or grieve too much, remember that man has been distorting God's plan for marriage long before today. Even marriages that are traditional, quote-unquote, may not be God-honoring when they are full of divorce, abuse, negativity, anger, jealousy, or just plain trying to be married on our own strength and not standing together in God's word, following Jesus and being led by Spirit. Remember, God defined and established marriage, and God's ways are above man's. Rather than be outraged or sad, strive to make marriage reflect Christ so that others may see Jesus in you. Show love to men, regardless of who or how or what they are. Even more so, love your enemy and those who oppose you. Writing new laws or defending old ones won't fix anything. Loving God and loving people will. Reflect Christ with your life and your marriage.
There's definitely a step up from most of the posts we're used to seeing.
Mm-hmm. Oh, well, one of my older family members who's a Christian, you know, said marriage equals one man, one woman. And I'm like, well, okay. That's one, you know, how are we ever going to become an intergalactic civilization if we can't recognize that there's probably more than one type of, you know, marriage, or more than two types of sexes, or more than, you know, we're so locked into the old traditional viewpoints of things, and we're so, you know, locked into this ignorant idea that it's only this way everywhere that, you know, We lose sight of the fact that there's probably other planets, other civilizations, other places out there that are probably totally different, you know? How do we ever expect to join, you know, an intergalactic community of interstellar planets if we ever, you know, if we can't get out of this stupid, you know?
Well, that's easy. A lot of people are so arrogant that they think that out of this whole big universe, Earth is the only little ball with life on it. And that there's nothing else out there anywhere. And Rich's modem, I think, just, like, crapped again. His internet access is a piece of crap. He's going to be switching providers. His current provider's just, wow. What happens when we end up running into androgynous beings? They have no gender. They're from Satan. We shun them. They came in demonic discs with no gender. That's Satan's trap to confuse us. We need to hurt them. Like, what? Welcome back, Rich. What I was saying is that's easy. A lot of people are so arrogant that they think that this planet's the only little ball with life on it. There's nothing else out there. And I said, what happens when we meet an androgynous being? Oh, they're landing in their satanic discs, and they have no gender. They're Satan's trap. They're going to hurt us, so we need to whip out our shotguns and shoot them. And, you know, like...
It's like, really, that's a way to greet the Vulcans?
I think a lot of people just aren't happy unless they just aren't happy. And I think that's what a lot of people's problem is. They like the thrill of hate, the thrill of feeling justified. And that is what the educational system teaches too. I mean, if you really look at it, how do they teach us? They don't encourage us to find out what we're good at and hone those skills. They're like, do it our way or you fail. You're a failure. If you don't blindly obey, blindly conform, you're a failure. And you need to hate everybody else who doesn't conform either, you know? And that's where we get bickering back and forth between different factions, political parties, whatever. Look at how society raises us to be. It teaches us that new is dangerous, different is bad, hate your neighbor, hurt your neighbor, be all for the self. And that's even in Christian schools, too. I grew up in a parochial school. That's what they taught me. They sugarcoated it with Jesus, but by their actions and, you know, by the way they taught us and their attitudes, they taught us, you're number one, fuck everybody else, but you're only number one if you blindly comply with the system. So if you're blindly complying, you're a good boy, good girl. And anybody who isn't blindly complying, well, go hate on them, hurt them, beat them, you know, whatever. Just go screw them over. That's what I was taught in school. How about you, Rich? Is that what you were taught in school?
Well, no. I mean, it really depends on where you go. I mean, there's the mainstream church, and there's the, you know, non-mainstream churches out there. I've been around both types of Christians, you know, and I know... Like, especially with some of my older family members, there are moments where they're very kind, very compassionate, very understanding. And then there's moments where, you know, they're locked into that psychological brainwash of, you know...
Hate everybody!
Yeah, hate everybody bullshit. You know. But it really depends. I mean, the church is kind of a fractal in and of itself because, I mean, there are so many different factions, so many different viewpoints, so many different of everything, and people are constantly bickering amongst each other like little children about what the Bible says that, you know, it's like, okay, so if this imaginary demon Satan really is out there, you know, doing all of this stuff, which I think is just a scapegoat for men's actions and nothing more.
I think there's lots of...
Men like to point at some little thing and say, oh, it's that red little thing that we have no proof exists out there, that little guy with the four horns and the tail.
There's lots of Satans, lots of demons. We've created them all. Monsanto among one, but, you know, there's lots of Satans and demons, and we've created them all. In fact, here's a story of something that happened to me in... like 7th and 8th grade. I know I've told this story plenty of times, but I'm not sure if I've ever told it on air. And I'm not sure if I've ever told it to either of you, but it's one of my more creepy parochial school moments, right? So I'm in religion class, and the pastor of the church, you know, was a religion teacher. So he's up there talking to the class about how much God loves us. Oh, God loves everybody so much, lovey-dovey-dub. In fact, he loves you so much that when you die and you go to heaven, God is going to have sex with each and every one of you. And I'm the whole class about turns green. I'm like, question. Yes, David. let me see if I got this right. I'm not sure if I'm misunderstanding. You're saying that when we die, when we go to heaven, that God is literally going to have sex, physical sex with every one of us. You know, we're talking about, you know, sex. I'm not misunderstanding you, right? No, you're not misunderstanding me, David. Every one of us, when we die, God is going to have sex with each and every one of us. And I'm just like, ew, creep. I mean, we didn't believe him, of course, but we just thought, like, ooh, look at Pastor Creepy over here. Blech.
Hey, can I finish something, a thought?
Sure.
Okay, so I read you that post, right? And so there are some comments coming in. There's this woman. She's saying, I feel like it's time for the church to let go of its dogmatic, rigid approach to same-sex marriage. We've done that with so many other things that we once used the Bible to prohibit. Women covering their hair, women having equal rights with men, outlawing slavery, allowing interracial relationships, and so on. So it seems strange to me that the church is still unwilling to re-examine this issue, see the severe damage their stance is doing to our gay and lesbian brothers and sisters, and look at the full cultural context and history of the passages we cite as being against homosexuality. This video was one of the first times I was exposed to the larger context of those passages, and I thought it was really helpful to me. I'd be curious to hear your thoughts about it sometime when you have a few minutes. And then there's a video that's an upworthy visual titled, There Are Six Scriptures about Homosexuality in the Bible. Here's what they say.
Why don't you hit screen share and then hit play?
Okay.
Just don't full screen the video because we don't want the censorship Nazis third party matching or anything, but if you leave it in just a little video window, then it should be all good.
Okay. Because, you know, talking about homosexuality is really, like, the theme of the day, I think.
Apparently.
It is a huge deal to everyone on Facebook right now. Alright, can you see my screen?
Yes.
Marriage equality is on the rise. But despite this trend, religious beliefs remain a major obstacle to acceptance. Many conservative Christians believe that the Bible condemns all same-sex relationships. That question drove my own intensive study of this issue when I came to terms with being gay, as both my parents and my church in Kansas believed that gay marriage was wrong. But what I learned when I studied the relevant scripture passages changed my parents' minds, along with the views of many other Christians in my life. There are six passages in the Bible that refer to same-sex behavior, three in the Old Testament and three in the New Testament. The most famous passage is the story of Sodom and Gomorrah. God sends two angels disguised as men into the city of Sodom, where the men of Sodom threaten to rape them. The angels blind the men, and God destroys the city. For centuries, this story was interpreted as God's judgment on same-sex relations. But the only form of same-sex behavior described is a threatened gang rape. Ezekiel 16:49 sums up the story's focus on violence and hostility toward strangers. Now this was the sin of your sister Sodom. She and her daughters were arrogant, overfed, and unconcerned. They did not help the poor and needy. In Leviticus 18:22, male same-sex intercourse is prohibited, and violators are to receive the death penalty. You shall not lie with a male as with a woman. It is an abomination. Other things called abominations in the Old Testament include having sex during a woman's menstrual period, eating pork, rabbit, or shellfish, and charging interest on loans. They're part of the Old Testament law code, which was fulfilled by Jesus. Hebrews 8:13 says that the old law is obsolete and aging. Romans 10 verse 4 says that Christ is the end of the law. So the Old Testament doesn't settle the issue for Christians. But let's look to the New Testament, which contains the longest reference to same-sex behavior in the Bible. In Romans 1, verses 26 and 27, people who turn away from God to worship idols are then turned over to their own lusts and vices. Even their women exchanged natural sexual relations for unnatural ones. In the same way, men committed shameful acts with other men and received in themselves the due penalty for their error. Paul's words here are clearly negative, but the behavior he condemns is lustful. He makes no mention of love, commitment, or faithfulness. His description of same-sex behavior is based solely on a burst of excess and lust. In the ancient world, same-sex behavior mainly occurred between adult men and adolescent boys, between masters and their slaves, or in prostitution. Most of the men engaged in those practices were married to women, so same-sex behavior was widely seen as stemming from out-of-control lust, a vice of excess, like gluttony or drunkenness. And while Paul labels same-sex behavior unnatural, he says in 1 Corinthians 11:14, "For men to wear their hair long also goes against nature," and most Christians interpret that as a reference to cultural conventions. In the last two likely references to same-sex behavior in the Bible, two Greek words, malakoi and arsenikoitai, are included in lists of people who will not inherit God's kingdom. Many modern translators have rendered these terms as sweeping statements about gay people, but the concept of sexual orientation didn't even exist in the ancient world. Yes, Paul did not take a positive view of same-sex relations, but the context he was writing in is worlds apart from gay people in committed, monogamous relationships. The Bible never addresses the issues of sexual orientation or same-sex marriage, so there's no reason why faithful Christians can't support their gay brothers and sisters. It's time. If you'd like to learn more, check out my new book, God and the Gay Christian. Then sign up with the Reformation Project to make a difference in your church.
Okay, guys. So that's the video that they're referencing.
And all I have to say to that is wait for the hardcores to go, "But no, that's not true, because I say so, and I'm right," and you know.
Would you want to hear the rest of the comments on the thread?
I can just hear it now.
Yeah, okay. So they said that I did watch the entire video, and I must say, once this was a different person, this is a third person. His name is Rusty. I did watch the entire video, and I must say, once again, someone twists the scriptures to support his own proclivity rather than surrender that proclivity to the influencing God and his word. And then the girl that posted the video said, "Or the modern church twists the scriptures out of context in order to justify bigotry against the gay community." And then Rusty says, "It sounds as though you've made up your mind." And then she says, "Likewise."
Mm-hmm.
And so then the person who posted the original feed says, "I am not anti-gay person. I'm not an anti-gay person. The thing that I think is sad is when people, gay or otherwise, are doing something that goes against God's design and demanding that a stamp of approval get put on it." And then the girl Rachel says, "I think if I were a gay person, it would be hard for me to differentiate your perspective from the feeling that you just didn't like me or care for me at all. Anyway, I just thought I'd share this video in case you were interested in it. Give it a look when you have a chance, at very least. It's always good to listen to differing perspectives." And then the guy says, "I have friends that I think do and say all sorts of things that aren't my favorite, and I'm sure some of my friends would agree that I do and think things that aren't their favorite either. We all do wrong stuff. We all sin. Bottom line, my opinion doesn't matter, because at the end of all of this, no one is going to be standing before me to be judged. I am in line with the rest of humanity. Whatever your thing is, ultimately, only God can judge me," which can be kind of scary, actually. "My responsibility, as I understand it, is to love God and obey him and all that it entails, and to share the good news of Jesus. It is not my job to convert or convince or persuade. It is my job to love God and to love people. Share the gospel, which unfortunately is super offensive to most people, even when done in love. My approval of one's life is meaningless, so no one should really be upset when I don't give it or rejoice when I do. And then the girl, Rachel, says, I'm not talking about approving of everything someone says or does. I'm talking about the fact that, sadly, many of our churches have become scary, unwelcoming places for gay people based on a few Bible verses that were taken out of context. That mistake has led us to act in very unchrist-like ways by making gay people who Christ would have welcomed in his company feel unwelcome and unaccepted. And then the guy says, the church as an entity has treated gay people horribly, but it doesn't end there. The quote-unquote church has also been unloving and even hateful at times to different races, children, elderly, homeless, mentally ill, physically handicapped, people with long hair, people with short hair, people with tattoos and or piercings, people who speak different languages. The list is pretty inclusive over the years. It's not right, and if Jesus were to come back today, I bet there would be a few churches that he would tell, depart from me, for I never knew you. It's not my job to change anyone's mind or convince anyone of anything. I can only apologize for those and even for myself at times that have done things to give people a reason to write God off. But loving someone doesn't equal agreeing with them or approving of their actions and choices. And then the girl, Rachel, says, I definitely agree with you that the church has treated and continues to treat many marginalized groups poorly. I guess we can agree to disagree as far as disapproving of someone's choices. First, I do not believe being gay is a choice, primarily because it is so hard to be gay. Why would someone choose to put themselves through that? And, as I said earlier, I think that there are a lot of layers of cultural and historical context to consider that make the Bible passages about homosexuality way less cut and dried than the modern church preaches. And then the guy says, I too have been treated horribly by many churches and by many people who call themselves Christians. By all human rights, I have every reason to hate the church and to dismiss God and feel very justified doing so. Or I could claim that I am a Christian but dismiss church. So many options. But it's between me and God and no one else. When I face God, I won't have the luxury of blaming someone else for my choices, behaviors, or actions. I just know that I am so glad and so grateful for the grace and forgiveness God has shown me. I'm thankful that he sought me out and showed love to me when I was running from him, when I was drunk, when I was in the middle of drugs and all other kinds of craziness. But I am also thankful that God loves me enough that he didn't leave me like that. He is drawing me closer and closer to himself. He is teaching me how to love and obey him. It's unfair and painful at times. Anyways, we're way off topic, but I just want to know, and I want you to know that I appreciate your sharing your opinions. My prayer is that you, me, and everyone else will just earnestly seek God. He's the only answer to the mess we've made of this world.
I want to play devil's advocate for a second. Mm-hmm. It's already been proven that homosexuality is a genetic thing. It's a genetic anomaly. And I think we could say that if everything was created by God, then so was DNA. So here's a question for the more hateful Christians out there. If God purposely, this is hypothetical, but if God purposely put homosexual DNA in somebody, then how can he send them to hell for something he did to them? That's not a fair God. That's not a loving God. That's not a merciful God. That's not anything. That's Satan to me. If you look at how we define God, define Satan. Satan is the deceiver, is the malicious one, is the troublemaker. So
right, there's even animals in the wild that are homosexual.
Yeah, exactly. So if homosexuality comes from genetics and God created genetics, well, God's going to send homosexuals to hell, then wouldn't God then literally be Satan and not God? Wouldn't God then be evil to force someone to be homosexuality and not give them a choice and then say, okay, that's your fault, so now I'm going to send you to hell for what I did to you? Would that be an act of God, or would that be an act of a satanic, demonic being? Food for thought, people.
Mm-hmm.
And what did Jesus preach? Did he say, hate your neighbor, go fuck with everybody, go to war? Did he say, write unconstitutional laws? Did he say, belittle people and make them feel like shit? Did he say, do any of that? Or did he say, love your neighbor, love your enemy, be that which you want to create? All the works I've done, also shall you do, and greater still. the same Father in me is also in you. We are all Christ. I am the Son of God. So are you. He's saying all these positive, uplifting things about humanity and saying that we've created the world the way it is, not God. God gave us free will choice. We've decided to be a bunch of fuck-ups, but then we pass the blame to God. In fact, the commandment that says, thou shalt not take the Lord's name in vain, that has nothing to do with saying, God damn it. Taking the Lord's name in vanity means swearing oath. I swear to God, it's not my fault. It's Satan. It's this other thing. It's these gays. It's the angels. It's demons. It's, oh, I can't take responsibility for my actions, so I swear to God, I swear oath to God, I take his name in vanity, in my own vanity. I swear oath in vanity that I'm not responsible for my own actions. That is what taking the Lord's name in vain means, and the church breaks every commandment, I'd say daily, but probably more like hourly. You know, these churches break every commandment, and they act all justified. They take the Lord's name in vain. They commit all this stupid, terrible bullshit, and they go, we're not doing nothing. God's got these Bible verses here and here, and this says that and that, and I can't control what Satan's doing over here, what that's over here. No, so, you know, Jesus died for our sins. Let's not disappoint him. Yay, it's not my fault.
Mm-hmm.
So people want to be hateful and act like they're loving Christians, but, you know, I can't see how if someone is constantly angry and making people feel like shit and trying to be a control freak on everybody and talking about Satan, fire, and brimstone. To me, that's who they're worshiping. That's what they're worshiping. That's what they view their reality to be. Oh, Satan's the only thing that's real. Misery's the only thing that's real. Fire and brimstone's the only thing that's real. Hate's the only thing that's real. That is the God they worship, which brings the commandment, thou shalt not have any other gods before me. That has nothing to do with little statues. That has to do with surrendering your power to dogma, to governments, to all of these belief systems that we worship, that, oh, misery is the only real reality, hate is the only real thing, I worship hate as my God, I worship misery as my God, that is my God. I'm going to say I'm Christian, I'm going to say I love people and I love Jesus, but by my actions and by my beliefs, Satan's my God, misery is my God, hell is my God, that is my God, I'm putting this God before God. But people don't want to face the truth that that's what they do. Mm-hmm. Every day. They don't want to face that.
Right. It's only.
That's why people are getting butthurt right now. This is the time for people to deal with their demons and face their shit, as Tobias Lars might say.
Mm-hmm. I think
all these false flags.
People are dealing with right now.
Yeah, all these false flags do is wake people up. All these political scandals do is wake people up. All these hateful Christians spewing crap do is wake people up. And people go, oh, wow, look at how hateful that is. Do I want to be like that, or maybe do I want to be better than that?
Mm-hmm.
So you've got all these reality checks happening on every level. You know, the whatever, if you want to call it, the globalists or the top 1% or whatever, different politics, religions, even beliefs about ourselves, you know. We might have family members around us that are very dysfunctional and always telling us, you're nothing, you're nobody, you're shit, I'm your authority, fuck you. And you don't have to be a teenager either. I mean, if a family member's always treated you like that, they're always going to treat you like that. That's who they're deciding to be. So that has, like, nothing to do with being a kid. It starts with being a kid, of course. And you get brainwashed by that. But then they keep it going into adulthood. Adulthood's a state of extended adolescence in today's society.
Mm-hmm.
So we're facing that, and we're looking at that and going, wow, do we really want to continue that? I know what my answer is, no. And I don't care how many people I piss off by being authentic, by being a good person, by treating others the way I think that they should be treated, by standing up for what I think is right, and for respecting others' rights to do the same, even when they don't agree with me, even when they're being hateful. So that's who I choose to be. I'm making my choice, and whoever doesn't like it, cool. Fuck them, but cool. They have the right to choose themselves.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, you know, it's just, we live in a society that's neurotically obsessed with hate, like a methamphetamine addict, and society as a whole is going through withdrawal, and, you know, there's a lot of chaos right now, you know. People are dying off left and right, you know. People at the same time are thriving left and right. I mean, it really just depends on where your energetics are lying. Some of us are going forth and prospering as the Bible would command, and some of us are just withering away and dying. I think the greatest sin, metaphorically speaking, to yourself, and not only that, to the world, is to be in such a shitty energetic state that, you know, the only thing you have to look forward to is dying. I see so many Christians, especially the ones I've been around, like, oh, I just can't wait to get to heaven. I just can't wait for it to be over. I just can't wait for it to end. I just can't wait for it to all be good and to all be right, and it just for it to not be a problem anymore, and to just, you know, go off to this happy, big, nice, white, pearly place, you know, up in the clouds somewhere, you know, this world's so fucked, there's nothing I can do, yada, yada, yada. I think that's the biggest sin of all. I think sitting there doubting yourself to the point where, you know, you're having all these serious health problems, and, you know, the Bible talks about that, you know. Taking care of yourself is like the first priority in terms of, you know, spiritual health, you know. Being physically healthy and realizing that the world isn't all shit and all doom and gloom and all terrible, you know. I see so many people brainwashed into the idea that we're in Armageddon right now and it's the end of everything and everything's going to burn and everything's going to blow up and God's going to come back with this vengeful, fiery wrath and destroy the planet and, you know, then castrate everybody and, you know, tell them what to do, and he's just going to rearrange everything how he sees fit and then cross his arms like a big bully and stand there like Mussolini shaking his head, you know, doing that whole dictator thing. No. The only thing Armageddon represents, the only thing that the book of Armageddon represents, the book of Revelations represents, the book, you know, some people call it the book of Armageddon or the book of Revelations, but the only thing that the book of Revelations really represents is the end of the old energy, the old age, the old paradigm, the old dysfunctional societal setup, and the beginning of the age of enlightenment, the age of heaven, the age of et cetera, the age of, you know, always has been, always, you know, is and always shall be, that type of thing.
Apocalypse means the knowledge that was once kept secret being revealed. So we are in apocalyptic times, I'll agree with that. All the secrets are coming out from the woodwork and people are getting butthurt because the truth contradicts what they've been taught.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
We are definitely in the apocalypse, that I agree with.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Yeah, I mean, in a metaphorical sense, we are in the quote-unquote end times, but it's not the end, it's merely the end of one way of thinking and doing and the beginning of another way of thinking and doing. We're exiting a dysfunctional reality and entering a functional reality that works.
People don't also realize that it's scientifically, biologically, and neurologically true that your thoughts and your emotions are like software, and your body's like computer hardware. So when you're sick, if you're going, oh, woe is me, I'm so sick, I feel so sick, I'm so sick, that's the reality, I'm sick, 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 that's the software through that operating system giving the command to your immune system saying, okay, guys, slack off. We've got our orders. We're not allowed to get healthy. We're sick. We have to be sick. We're not allowed to get healthy. We've been given our orders. And people don't realize that's how it works. And that is true. That has been proven. And anybody could ask any neurologist or psychologist or biologist about it. And, you know, and they'll even tell you about how every emotion resonates in an energetic frequency. You have a central nervous system, right? And there's matching neural peptide in your hypothalamus to each frequency. So when you're feeling something, you're triggering that. Okay, local Walgreens CVS built into my head. Let's get me those drugs. So that matching chemical gets pumped into your bloodstream, and the more corrosive and nasty a chemical is, the more addictive it is, as we could see with heroin and things like that. As a matter of fact, heroin was made to match the neural peptides that are already in there. That's how it tricks your cells to let the stuff in. It thinks it's a biological juice when really it's not. It's artificial. It sneaks in and boom, you know. So, I mean, that's scientifically true. So, yeah, and the more corrosive that is, I'll tell you how corrosive stress hormone is. Artificial stress hormone is used in the drug that, you know, like if you have a heart transplant or something, or any sort of organ, in the anti-organ rejection drugs, artificial stress hormone is used in that drug because the artificial stress hormone shuts down the person's immune system. Because without that shutdown, their immune system would attack the new organ as a foreign invader. There would be no time.
All of this stuff that you're saying about the biology of illness and everything like that, I need you, when you edit this video, I need that section that you just said, and I need that, like, to digest it, because I want to put that in my book. Of course, I'll credit you and everything with what you're saying, but I want to put that in my book, because I've been trying to...
Well, this is a live stream. It's not an edit. It's a live stream. So, yeah. I mean, if you want... Give you a link with the timestamp where it begins. I could find that in there. And okay, here's where it starts.
Mm-hmm. Anyways, sorry.
It's okay. But yeah, I mean, I pretty much said it. So that's not airy fairy, new agey, or whatever. Everything is made of energy. That's literal. You have a central nervous system that's got energy going up and down. That's literal. Your body's an electrochemical computer. Your emotions and psychology is the software, so to speak, to the hardware. That's the control center. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, what we think and what we believe does determine our health. So, it, like with me, when I lost all the weight I lost, it didn't matter what I did before shifting the state of being. I was commanding the body. I'm fat. That's the only thing. Immune system sucks. I'm fat. I'm this, I'm that. So no matter what I did, nothing worked. I had to really start to shift, you know. So then I was able to start dropping the weight. Most people also don't understand that when the body is lacking nutrition, it automatically puts on weight as a defense mechanism. It's like, uh-oh, we're starving. We need our surplus so we don't die. So it puts on weight as a defense mechanism. And even a lot of these so-called healthy vegetables and canned stuff are genetically modified to be nutrient deficient. And it's understandable. The Food and Drug Administration, right? Food and drug. The two are together for a reason. The health industry is an industry. It's not there to make you healthy. If it was there to make you healthy, it would put itself out of business. It's there to keep you sick. So you can keep coming back for more of those drugs. Take a drug. So yeah, those are the biggest drug pushers and drug dealers on the planet. Don't concern yourself so much with the street pushers. Concern yourself more with the big pharmaceutical companies. Those are the ones really killing people. Look at all the stupid side effects. May cause internal bleeding, and your head might come off, and your spine might disintegrate, and your bowels might explode, and all this nasty shit. You're looking at it like, what? And what it's really telling me is, those aren't the side effects. That's what the drug does. The side effect is that it might possibly ease this one problem you have. That's a side effect. What the drug actually does is kill you. So, but people aren't taught to think critically. Otherwise, they'd put that together real quick.
Mm-hmm.
And also, fluoride is made from fluorine, which is rat poison. Don't believe me? Go into the store and look at the key ingredient on rat poison. It'll tell you it's fluorine. Go look it up how it's created. It's a product, a toxic waste product from aluminum processing. So, I mean, this shit's all on the books. I mean, you know, this isn't conspiracy theory or woo-woo. I mean, any moron can research it and see. Why do you think on the toothpaste bottle it says, if you swallow the toothpaste, call poison control immediately?
Oh, you just sparked what I was going to talk about earlier. Speaking of aluminum particulates and, you know, aluminum and all that stuff.
Geoengineering and how they use the aluminum in the jet fuel to make it burn hotter, but then it sticks around and kills trees.
Yeah. Let me pull up. I've got the partial poster. I can screen share it. Okay, where is it? Looking for it. I'll find it. It's in here somewhere. Got it in my downloads. Geoengineering aerosol spraying. There we go. Okay. Can you all see this?
Yes. Okay. You know, even though I don't have my migraine headache anymore, my body is still in retaliation. I mean, I feel like I've been run over by a truck.
Anyway, I got this at the truck stop last night. I didn't see who brought it in, but somebody brought it in to our shift manager, and she just put it down, and I saw it. And I decided to bring it home because I thought it would be an interesting thing. But, yeah, essentially you can see kind of up in the corner. I couldn't get the whole picture of it, but... it shows a geoengineering aerosol spraying aircraft that, from my professional eyes, is a airliner. I can tell by the side of it, it's a American Airlines painted aircraft, if it's a legitimate American Airlines 747. But you can see up here where the engines are as compared to where the nozzles are. I don't know if it's, you know, if that's a legit photo, if it's a Photoshop photo, I don't know. I'm not making judgment calls on it. I'm just viewing it as information at this point. But I do know that they, you know, and there is videos out there where they talk about it. They are putting aluminum particulates into the fuel. It's still debatable whether that's what's causing the fuel to, if that's what makes the fuel do what it does when it hits the atmosphere and turns into a white puffy cloud. You know, normal fuel could do that. There's no way to really test it at this point because, as far as we know, all the fuel's tampered with aluminum particulates, and there's no real way to compare and contrast the two to see. As the scientific method would mandate. But anyway, basically, the aluminum particulates are, you know, essentially, it's a more high-tech version of, like, the Romans salting the fields so that way the crops can't grow. It's really, you know, they're poisoning our atmosphere to then over the long term of, you know, say 30 or 40 years of that, basically turn wherever they've sprayed and whatever they've done into a wasteland. And, you know, Monsanto, this is on record, is creating drought and aluminum and UV-resistant seeds. Why are they creating aluminum and UV-resistant seeds? That's the question. If they're not doing something, why are they creating seeds that are designed to withstand those things? You know, and we're already beginning to see the signs of severe drought in California. California's only got a year of water left. We're seeing flooding like Katerina experienced down in Texas that's off the charts. You know, streams overflowing and people's houses getting destroyed and, you know, severe storms down in the southern states, you know. And we've seen radical increases in Alzheimer's disease and autism that are just off the charts, you know. We're seeing random bird die-offs, honeybee die-offs. And here locally, you know, forest fires are a big thing in Oregon. Same with California, you know, forest fires are getting worse and worse by the year, consuming more and more acreage, you know, and that's mainly because these aluminum particulates absorb into the trees absorb that in with everything else, and, you know, it gets absorbed into the wood, and, you know, essentially it makes the wood burn more efficiently, makes it burn hotter, you know, and trees over time get so saturated that they die because they've absorbed so much of that stuff into them, you know. I mean, there's just so much, and then in the wintertime, you know, we see these massive snowstorms, you know, over on the East Coast. I mean, the weather patterns are totally, you know.
Here in Chicago, it's made it easy for carpenter ants to invade trees, so the branches are really weak because they're more hollowed out than they normally would be, and you got a good wind gust pick up on a good storm or something, the branch snaps off, could kill somebody, smash somebody's car, whatever. My dad had the front of his car smashed from exactly that sort of thing. And I've even seen plant leaves basically sweating out the aluminum, for lack of a better term. You've got the silver flaky coating on the top of aluminum, and that's actually coming out of the pores of the leaves. And, you know, I had never seen plants do that before, prior to that, and now it's like, what the fuck, where's these aluminum particles coming from? It's like, oh, because, yeah, I mean, you know, whether you want to call it geoengineering, chemtrails, or whatever, I've seen it for years, every day of my whole life. I'm in Chicago, you know, I remember when there was a normal sky and no chemtrailing, and over time, they just increased it and increased it and increased it. And I'm sorry, but you can't tell me that the tic-tac-toe patterns they make in the sky are just random by nature. Like, oh yeah, the wind just drifted into a fucking checkerboard. Yeah, I'm sorry, I'm not looking to buy oceanfront property in Iowa right now. Thank you, but no thank you. So, I mean, I've seen this stuff. Katerina was here, she's seen it. We did a video on it. She's looking up like, Jesus Christ, this is real. What the fuck? You see, she's like, what is wrong here? God! So, yeah. She's been here. She's seen it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. I mean, you know. No, they are literally trying. I mean, it's really when you connect the dots. I mean, doing it in such a way that nobody really sees it coming. I mean, it's really falling into the Agenda 21 thing. They're trying to drive people out of the rural areas, get them into the big cities where they can control them. It's, you know, a very typical, you know, globalist move.
Sorry, guys, I'm just responding to somebody.
That's cool. I know there's been a lot of views, especially on Facebook, with the video that you and Helene made recently, and my little version of that. I cut out everything that didn't have to do with society. And hold on a minute. What's up? We're live on the air.
Let's go ahead. We're live.
Hey, Wally!
Hey!
How are you?
Good. I'm still alive and kicking.
You are? Good.
Yeah.
Help me.
What's that? A haunted house thing?
Yeah. I'm going to scare the hell out of Katie tonight. I'm getting tired. You're ready to go to bed. I'm going to hit this baby up.
Oh, my God.
Oh, yeah.
That's awful.
Yeah, she's going to be jumping out of her bed and running all over the place.
Get the thing away from me. No, we're all alive, huh? Nobody's dead.
Nope.
I like this one. Got that nice squeaky door. Footsteps. Actually, it sounds like two birds having sex. You ever heard birds having sex, man? They're noisy.
Two eagles, you know.
Yeah.
Damn, your dad's hilarious.
I hit my phone once in a while. What the heck? So how is everybody? On drugs, doing good or what?
You're doing really well.
Smoking a little bit of the good stuff?
Well, no, I just took my first employee UA, so that probably wouldn't be a wise decision.
Oh, that's good for you.
He just got a new job at Million Air,
ooh,
which is an air service thing. It's dealing with aircraft.
Oh, you can't smoke anything then.
Nope.
No, you're cut off.
You get tested.
You're cut off. Well, you know, when you go on vacation, have a little bit or something. So you can play with airplanes or what?
Yep, get a fuel them, get a taxi them.
Oh, nice. Maybe you could check out the chemtrail planes, huh?
Well, maybe not.
You know, it's unreal how many people don't know about that. I was at the VA yesterday, and they're a bunch of big dummies.
Mm-hmm.
They don't know jack squat.
Yeah, the Vietnam vet.
I'm telling them, get on the computer and go to a veteran site and check it out. You're going to get educated. Keepers.
I've seen plenty of footage from Vietnam where they're spraying Agent Orange and they're spraying all of those different
stuff. Yeah. I used to take a shower in Agent Orange.
Agent Orange, a Roundup.
Yeah, I was a door gunner and the stuff we used to pull security for them and the stuff would just be spraying in our faces.
Oh my god.
Dioxin.
Yeah, it's unreal.
Agent Orange, aka Roundup, because that's what Agent Orange is. It's the same thing.
The nickname for that stuff was the Purple People Eater. Stuff that could kill every type of foliage known to mankind.
We just took showers in I don't know how many guys were sick from that, but I got lucky. It never affected me at all. Like, they can't find a trace.
Yeah, I'm part Martian because he's not human in the first place.
Really? Oh, hey, put your antennas back down. That's why he wears a hat. So his antennas don't pop out. I don't know if you've ever seen that old skit with My Favorite Martian. Really hilarious. He had these antennas that would pop up out of his head.
Yeah, it's that antenna scraping that causes the early balding, you know. Yeah. It just rubs against there and just...
I thought that was because you were using sandpaper to keep your hair short.
Ouch.
Yeah, I'm catching up with you, so.
No, I
look at that.
No,
I got to catch up with him. No, he can't catch up with me.
No, I use sandpaper to keep my testicles.
Use more ketchup. That's what they tell me.
Gross.
Rub your head with ketchup. It's supposed to make your hair grow back.
Really?
Use sandpaper.
Hey, he'll be a redhead.
use sandpaper to clean your testicles. It invigorates better than
Viagra. Really?
Yeah.
They do that on Mars?
Give it a try.
They do it on Mars?
You tell me. You came from there.
Hell, why don't you just use one of them electric sanders? It's easier.
Yeah, this is a great conversation to have.
Oh, David's fault. He's the one who brought it up.
Yeah, Dave's gross. I know.
He's totally gross.
Yeah.
Apple He'll tell you part and you want to know that's how gross he is.
I've got my gross national product right there.
Well, you know, when you sit on your brains, that's what happens. There's no other way around it. Mm-hmm. I sit on mine all the time. Keeps them warm.
He would know.
Yeah. I have warm brains in the wintertime.
Anyway, we're going to go back to the subject of geoengineering now.
Okay, go ahead. I'll leave you be. Mm-hmm. I'll be you leave.
Yeah, leave me butterfly.
Yeah. Why are you wearing sunglasses? Is it too bright in here?
Because I can.
Because
you were all wearing our sunglasses.
No. We were all wearing glasses.
Oh, really?
Katerina even had hers on. She had a hat on.
This is the new thing, huh? Sunglasses.
Just because we can.
Oh, hmm. I'll have to think about that.
About it on the can.
I'm gonna get going soon, guys.
Don't go too hard, you might hurt yourself.
You're funny.
At least fun.
Yeah. Yeah, Rochelle couldn't make it, and Kristen's disappeared into some black hole somewhere. I don't know where she's at.
Mm-hmm.
And Jay's recovering from being in the hospital.
He's in a gay pride parade right now, I'm sure. Like, oh,
nah, he's got a hole in his throat.
No. She. Really...
Hmm?
Kristen.
Oh. Yeah. That's a good theory. But Jay is recovering from being in a coma.
Mm-hmm.
And we are recovering from my dad.
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, Rich, you were saying prior to our unscheduled intermission.
Well, that was kind of a synchronistic intermission. He just starts randomly talking about geoengineering.
Yep.
Oh, it's just, you know, I've grown up in aviation my whole life, so, I mean, personally myself, I mean, you know, I'm, you know, just totally on the fence, you know, when it comes to chemtrails, or, you know, how they're doing it. I know they're doing it. They're obviously doing it because there are aviation experts coming out saying they're doing it. They're doing it, you know. But I've always kind of been, you know, on the fence of, you know, mainly it's just kind of seeing the trails of those white puffy clouds. I mean, is it aluminum that causes that? Is it just standard jet fuel itself? Is it, you know, I mean, there's all kinds of different, you know, the atmosphere is a very moist and, you know, flowing type. It's almost kind of like an aerial ocean. It's, you know, there's moist pockets of air, there's dry pockets of air, there's warm pockets of air, there's cold pockets of air. You know, moisture does stuff in the air, you know, when an engine's, you know, contrail condenses and hits the atmosphere, it expands and, you know, leaves this trail. You know, kind of like taking a breath, but, you know, I just have a lot of questions still kind of around the whole premise of, you know, is what they put, is aluminum particulate, are aluminum particulates the cornerstone reason that, you know, we see one side of the horizon all the way to the other side of the horizon, or is that just the fuel doing what fuel does? Or, you know, is there another equation here? That's just my main question. I mean, I totally believe that, you know, without a doubt, that they are doing, you know, geoengineering, you know, in multiple different ways, whether they're contracting private companies to do it with their own specially modified aircraft, or they're putting it in the jet fuel, or the military's doing it in their own private experiment studies, you know, that nobody really knows about because it's top secret. I mean, there's all kinds of different ways that they could be doing it. When me and Dave first talked about it, you know, I was one of those, you know, rather traditional skeptics of, oh, if they're going to be doing it, it's only going to be in one fashion or one form, or, you know, it's only going to be these certain things only that's going to allow it to happen, you know. But really, when you think about it and who the elites are and how they do things, they can do multiple expressions of the same exact thing, and you wouldn't even know about it because you're too busy arguing over the semantics of the situation as to how or to why or to, you know, to whatever reason, you know. It's just, you know.
Yeah, if the truth movement would stop bickering and bitching about exactly how 9/11 is done and just accept that they all agree on the fact that it was done, then they could open up an investigation and find out what was what, instead of bickering about, no, it was this, no, it was that, no, it was that, when chances are they're probably all right, because a little bit of each element was used simultaneously just to get people fighting and thrown off track.
It's a typical psychological move of globalists that get us all arguing over the semantics of the situation, and We missed the point totally that we're in agreement that it's happening, and, you know, we're too busy arguing with each other as to why or as to how.
It's like two little kids fighting over a toy, you know? No, it's mine. No, it's mine. Shut up. It's my toy. No, it's mine.
It's mine because the Tonka truck has a little blue stripe. No, mine because it has a little dimple in the little gravel chute, you know, the gravel bed on the back of it. No, it's mine because...
I think Katerina's not hearing you properly. She thinks you're saying mime. You're saying mime. I think...
Bye.
Mime.
Au revoir.
You're saying bye.
Goodbye.
You're going now.
Doesn't it, Danya?
Catch you later, my beautiful friend.
Hasta luego.
Doesn't it, Danya?
Hasta luego.
Later.
Au revoir.
Love ya. See ya.
Take care.
And then there were two.
Mm-hmm.
Man, I'm just squirming around over here like a wiggle worm and coughing stuff up because my body's just in retaliation because the local gas station had all this really healthy stuff on sale. I mean, I eat pretty healthy as it is, but, you know, I don't really like the taste of straight water, and so, you know, pop or soda, whatever someone wants to refer to it as, that's the thing I tend to drink. You know, Dr. Pepper mainly, or, you know, Cherry RC, things like that. And, you know, I went into the store, and they were all out of what I would usually get. But they had all this healthy stuff on sale. So I'm like, okay, well, that's cool. Looks like a synchronicity to me. I'm always talking about health and stuff. Maybe this is the universe just letting me know to take it to the next level. So figured, why not? Interesting little experiment. So, yeah, I guess I'm getting cleared out and my ass kicked. Whatever. It's like every fiber of my physical being is in freaking retaliation. I had the mother of all freaking migraines last night. Ugh. Right now, just my body's in retaliation. But, you know, that's kind of what happens when you're clearing out toxins. A lot of times, it's not a fun process. That's why people are always afraid of clearings and cleansings and things like that and detoxes, because they don't want to go through all that. But in my opinion, it's not really all that bad as long as you don't judge it. Just hold yourself in a state of appreciation of, all right, my immune system's kicking up. It's doing what it needs to do. This is a good thing. This is a positive thing. There's no reason for me to be all butthurt about it. Yeah, some of the symptoms are mildly annoying, but, you know, that's okay. I don't need to let that control what I think and how I feel. I can just look at it and have my opinion of, well, this kind of sucks, and just let it be my opinion. Oh.
Ooh. Yep.
Yeah, I don't think there isn't a part of my body that hurts right now. I mean, even though I don't have a migraine, I'm still hurting everywhere.
Yeah, it's just a sign of detox.
Yep.
Been going through that often, off and on, off and on, off and on lately.
Yep. Sometimes detox feels good and sometimes it don't. Like if you start taking dead sea salt so that calcium and magnesium balance out, that actually feels good. You can just like feel that rejuvenation inside of you. It's like, oh yeah, that's working. That's awesome. I feel things stabilizing. But that's just creating a stabilization. That's not kicking out a toxin. When you've got a situation where you're kicking out toxins, oh, just brace for fucking impact. Just,
you know. It's going to be a shitty time until it comes out.
Mm-hmm. So it's just maintain yourself in as high of a state of being as possible. Not delusionally. I don't mean ignore that you're sick. I don't mean like, shun the dark sickness, love and light. That's not what I fucking mean. I mean, you could still be in a state of appreciation while simultaneously thinking, wow, this fucking sucks. You know, you can appreciate things while you're feeling like shit. Only society says you can't. But it's contradictory. You can't do that. If you can, little kids do that all the time. They're out there having fun while simultaneously talking about all the things they don't like. Little kids do it all the time. It's just we've been narrowed. So we got to kind of get back to that. That's why Jesus says, be like a child. You know, empty your cup of all those prejudices and biases. Allow for a more expanded view. People think that means to open yourself up to be brainwashed. No. If you keep your mind narrowed, that's opening yourself up to be brainwashed.
Mm-hmm. It's really interesting. I just found a really good inspiring photo. It shows this girl sitting on a train. I'm sure with Kristen, but it says, in a society that profits from your self-doubt, liking yourself is a rebellious act.
Mm-hmm. Totally. Share that on PSEC too on Facebook.
Okay, I will.
That's a good one. And it's true. Yeah, what happens when you try to have a even a slightly high opinion of yourself, just acknowledging what you are? Oh, you're narcissistic. You're arrogant. You're selfish. You're apathetic. You think you're better than everyone else. You're a dirty, horrible, mean person. When really that's all just slander. The truth is that if you want to share a plate of cookies with people, you have to have a plate of cookies first. Otherwise, you don't got jack to share. And if you have a low self-esteem, you're fucked. You have no plate of cookies. Sorry. There's no cookies. No cookies for you.
Mm-hmm. I really don't get the black community in this country.
Well, let's be fair, part of the black community in this country.
Well, part of the black community. I mean, you know, the mainstream black community. I don't get them.
Idiots don't represent the whole. They are the minority.
No, I know. I'm just saying, I don't get, you know, people who, you know, think it's okay to, you know, claim that they're for racial equality for their own race, but yet spew nothing but, you know, bigotry and slander and hatred and view white people with some sort of suspicion and hatred and distrust. It's like, you know, grow up. You probably weren't related to a slave. Probably nobody in your family was a slave. You're just an ungrateful little piece of trailer trash, or frankly, a nigger. I'm going to say it. Yes, I said it. And that does not mean a good, outstanding, hardworking African-American. There are plenty of those out there. I'm mm-hmm. friends with, I have family members who are fine examples of what an African-American should
just
be.
Like there's a difference between, you know, a total piece of white trash and, you know, a white person who has integrity. You know, this is all about what you might want to refer to as, like, reverse racism, like the indoctrination that states the only people who could possibly be racist are white people, so let's blame the KKK and the Nazi, whereas no one of any other skin color could possibly do anything wrong, couldn't possibly be racist. Not at all. And if you try to call them a racist, then you're a racist. It's like, what?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, it's you know, off the charts stupid how people act about it. People think, you know, that all racism, period, is a white-on-black issue. It's a human-upon-human issue.
Mm-hmm.
Society teaches us to judge each other based upon class, upon wealth, upon what religion you're part of. Skin color is just one contributing factor. It's probably one of the smallest.
Age, gender, sexuality, the whole gamut. Anything they use to divide you and conquer you, they're going to use.
Yeah, the elites
are going to find all of it. I mean the scumbags running everything. I don't mean the average person.
Yeah, the elites use all of those factors to pit us all against each other like a bunch of little children, where we're slapping and beating each other up. You know, you got a bunch of pissed off black guys who think they're tough shit but are dumber than a monkey on crack cocaine. You know, and then you got a bunch of white guys on the same side that are dumber than a monkey on crack cocaine. You got a bunch of Asians that are dumber than a bunch of monkeys on crack cocaine. You got a bunch of Mexicans that are dumber.
In all fairness. In all fairness, George W. Bush does look a lot more like a monkey than Obama, in all fairness.
Yeah, he does.
Obama just looks like a whiny little fucking bitch. Now, George W. Bush, he looks like he could be swinging from some fucking trees.
Mm-hmm. WMDs. I'm from Texas.
I wouldn't mind him being a dictatorship, as long as I'm a dictator.
Now, son, you're doing a really good work for the New World Order. This is George Herbert Walker Bush. You're doing a great deal for the New World Order. Son, I'm very proud of you.
Get out of the fucking tree.
Get out of the fucking tree before someone sees you. I flew a Curtiss TBM Hell Diver, and I abandoned my crew in the Pacific. Because I was a coward, and I decided to jump out of the airplane, because the captain's supposed to stay with the ship, but not me. I had a political career for the New World Order. No, I'm just, you know, people get all butthurt about race, and, you know, they get butthurt when you use the N-word, especially the N-word, like I stated earlier. And I'm just at the point of, I don't give a shit anymore. I don't give a shit. I'll say nigger as many times as I want. First Amendment right. If a black guy doesn't like that, tough. I'm sorry. If he's offended by that, he should be examining his character. Mm-hmm. Has he been acting like trailer trash? Because if you've been acting like trailer trash, what do you expect to come upon you? You're living on welfare. You're living on food stamps. You got an Obama phone. You look like trash. How do you expect people to treat you? Yeah, same goes with white people. You know, you're fucking dumbass, you know, stupid inbred, you know, southerner who, you know, hates black people just because of their color. And I'm not saying all rednecks are that way. I'm a redneck. And not all black people were hateful. Let me say that right now. I can't tell you how many times I'm going to say that. But, you know, if you're walking around in Walmart with your fucking tidy whiteys and welfare stamps, and you got a big beer belly, and you're wearing nothing but your tidy whiteys and flip flops, and you got your girlfriend that's wearing a wrinkly ass Confederate rebel flag bikini, and her tits look like something that got whacked with a sledgehammer and put through a meat grinder. How do you expect people to look at you? Do you expect them to think you're outstanding citizens for society? No, they're probably going to think of you as white trailer trash. And then to the Asians who walk around thinking they're, you know, tough shit and whatever, those racist type Asians who think that they're the coolest guys. Why do you think people call you slanted-eyed yellow bastards? Because you act like it. You walk around saying we need to, you know, because there have been people in the past who have done stuff like that, you know. There was a police case back in the 70s where they dealt with some guy who believed that Japan needed to be imperially ruled by the emperor and all that stuff, and that we needed to kick out the Western way of life. I'm talking about those kind of guys. Yeah. How do you expect people to treat you? Do you expect people to treat you like, you know, you're some normal citizen of society or something, or, you know, treat you like you know, you're an outstanding person, when all you can do is talk about how much you hate whites and how much, you know, Asians are superior to everybody? I mean, look at the North Koreans. They're the biggest freaking, you know, centralist racists on the planet. They hate their own brothers in the South. They hate the Japanese. They barely stand the Chinese. They may lie to them and say that they're friends, but, you know, it's total racism. I mean, the Koreans and the Japanese have been doing it to each other all the time. I mean, hell, in Africa, for Christ's sake, you know, why is Africa so divvied up? It's because you got all these different tribes that rule over these countries. I mean, Kenya is a prime example. You got the main ruling party, the Kikuyu. You've got the main, the sub-parties underneath. And they've always constantly been suspicious of each other, of hating each other, of not liking each other. And this is a black on black issue. This has nothing to do with white people. This has nothing to do with imperialism. This has nothing to do with anything with white on black. This has strictly to do with tribe versus tribe in Africa. It happens all the time. There are Africans that hate each other just because they're from a different tribe. It has nothing to do with, you know, whites going in there like in that, you know, freaking piece of garbage propaganda where they're showing white people chaining blacks up and dragging them to the boat. You know, has nothing to do with that. That's not even a proper analysis of history. That's a total lie that the leftist media, that the media in general, you know, the perverted mainstream media has pushed and said, you know, it was because of us that Africa turned into a backwards shithole. No, Africa, for Christ's sake, has always been, you know, this very harsh tribalistic type thing. Our introduction to the continent did absolutely nothing to change the balance. There were major empires in Africa that owned slaves from other tribes and, you know, ruled over them like property, you know, and would trade them as property to, you know, the Arabs, and then the Arabs would trade them as property to the...
Sorry, I'll be right back. I just need to piss, but I just want to let you know I'll be right back. Just in case are you there and there's, like, nothing, and you're like, what the fuck? I'm just taking a piss.
Okay. But anyway, back onto the main subject. It's the same type of thing. Then you have the Arabs that trade them over to, you know, the Americans or the English or, you know, some other European colonial power, and then, you know, use them as slaves. I mean, slavery is a human issue. It's been something that's been going on throughout history. Every race has done it. The Chinese owned, you know, had their own people as slaves. You know, they had concubines. They had, you know, indentured servants. I mean, hell, indentured servants in the New World, in the United States, mind you, and even in the South, were treated worse than, you know, blacks. There were white indentured servants that were owned by Southern plantation owners, and even black plantation owners. There were black plantation owners in the South that owned slaves. Historical record, proven fact. There were actually more black plantation owners than there were white plantation owners. They owned tons of slaves. Some of the biggest slave owners in the South were black that were once slaves, and they took advantage of that system. So it's really not a color issue. It's a human issue. Slavery exists. It still exists. We shouldn't be questioning the deeds of the past. What we need to be questioning is the deeds, you know, should we be continuing this, you know, cycle, or should we be preventing it, stopping it, and realizing that slavery is wrong, that racism is wrong, that hating each other just because we may do things differently is wrong, and realize that we're all fucking human. We're all going to be different. We're all individuals. God created us uniquely in our own right. I'm sorry, but, you know, racism isn't just a white on all minorities issue. That's a crock of shit that the media has thrown out there to say that white's bad. Check your privilege. That's a crock of shit. So I need to check my, you know, so I need to check my privilege because, you know, there are plenty of people within my race that, you know, were indentured servants. Should they check their privilege because they were slaves to some plantation owner somewhere? Do they have to check privilege? No, I don't think they have to check their privilege. They were treated worse than the black slaves back, you know. It's not a race issue. The race issue is a crock of shit. It's non-existent. It's just nothing more than a mirror. It's a human issue. There are still slaves, women treated worse than, you know, slaves in the Middle East, you know, not allowed to drive, not allowed to go outside without a male relative, not allowed to do anything unless there's a male family member involved. I mean, that's still going on. Does anybody question that? No, we're not going to question that issue. That doesn't matter, but we will question, you know, this non-existent issue that's been dead since the 1960s, why don't we leave it there, of race, for Christ's sake? I mean, get over it. And I'm saying that to everybody on both sides. Get over it. Get over the race card. Get over the bullshit. Get over the butthurt. It's a dead issue. What we need to be focusing on is why it's still going on. Not you know, something that happened, you know, 50 years ago. I don't care about something that happened 50 years ago. It happened. Obviously, the best path, humanity's taken the best path since then. You know, I know plenty of African Americans out there that are wonderful people, and I love them. They're good people. There are good and bad in every race, every color, every creed, every religion, everywhere, all at once. It's, you know, there's no, absolutely no need to continue bickering like children over past events that are dead, that are history. You know, I'm not saying don't remember that they happened, but we need to stop fighting with each other. That's what the elites want. They want us to be divided against each other. They want us to be pointing, you know, cannons at each other, getting ready to fire the volley at each other. Hey, quit it. You know, that's what they want. They want us fighting against one another. They want, you know, brother against brother, you know, sister against sister. They want people, you know, pulling out their knives, their guns, or whatever at each other and blowing each other away. That's not what's called for here. You know, people from all sides, all colors, all creeds need to come together and need to realize that, you know, that fighting against each other isn't going to solve anything. It's just going to make things worse. It accomplishes nothing, whether it's, you know, Americans versus Muslims, or, you know, blacks versus whites, or Asians versus Asians, or whatever metaphors you want to throw in there. That's not going to solve anything. That's just more bickering amongst each other. We need to realize that there are men in power that are using our differences against one another and causing us to fight. What we need to be doing is we need to be, you know, realizing that there's a problem. We need to realize that slavery and bondage, you know, in obedience to these ruthless tyrants is the issue. We need to realize that as humans, we have rights to be free men and free, you know, free men and women out there. You know, we all have rights to be free and not be under somebody's boot or thumb. We need to realize as a species, you know, as a sentient race on this planet, that, you know, the only way we're going to move forward is when we drop our differences and unite on the things that we do have in common and push towards a better future. That's the only way things are going to get better. It's not going to get better through, you know, one side killing all of the other different opinions. That's Nazism. That's a wet dream. And, you know, unfortunately, everybody's in every corner has been brainwashed with this, you know, societal malware that, you know, we're fighting for God, or we're fighting for righteousness, or we're fighting for some, you know, pseudo fake cause, you know, that because, well, we're the only ones that are justified to feel how we feel, and therefore we're the only ones that are right. You know, every side is guilty of that. They need to drop that dogma and realize that's not the way. That the way is,
I'm back, just letting you know.
Oh, welcome back. But anyway, the way is to unite together and to push forward and, you know, fight the globalists as a united humanity, not as a bunch of little children who can't seem to get over whether or not, you know, they're gay or straight or black or white or yellow or purple or, you know, Muslim or Christian or, you know, Mormon or Jew or whatever the classification for hatred or fear may be. We need to drop the dogma and unite together on common goals and common interests that will benefit all. That, you know, we can't keep this little bickering going, you know, vote for this candidate, vote for that candidate. We can't, you know, that gets you nowhere. It's a dead end. It's a dead end because all it does in the end is keeps people bickering amongst themselves like little children. You know, the only way to fight the globalists is to not fall for their societal dogma, to stand up against them as a united front. The only way to assured victory is through unified victory, not through, you know, differences and fear and hatred. And, you know, we've got to unite as a species. We've got to unite as humans and not, you know, unify for all of these tiny little secular reasons that are in the end just nothing more than more tiny little factions of Nazism.
And uniting doesn't mean saying kumbaya around the campfire, by the way. Joe can still think John's an annoying piece of shit idiot. It just means, you know, Joe and John have agreed to stop fighting because there's better things to do. It doesn't mean Joe and John have a high opinion of each other. You know, Joe can think John's a motherfucker, and John can think Joe's a crazy son of a bitch, whatever. That can still remain, but you're just putting aside the conflict.
Exactly. I don't have a problem with people's opinions. I don't have a problem with people's perspectives. I don't have a problem with people's right to free speech. I just have a real problem with people who seem to need to take their views and try to, you know, psychologically project onto others to the point where, you know, people are shooting each other, beating each other up, getting into riots, you know, fighting over stupid, trivial things. I mean, really, humanity's at that phase of where we're fighting. Basically, humanity's fighting over a popcorn kernel, if you want to put it into that perspective. Humanity is starving for knowledge, and the popcorn kernel is there, and people are tearing off their little chunks of the kernel and saying, oh, this is the only real kernel. This is the only real reality. Fuck your other piece. This is it, you know. And everybody's fighting over, you know, it's really that trivial. It's that stupid. It's that stupid. Whether it's the race issue, the religion issue, or whatever issue you want to classify it as, it's that stupid. It's that retarded. And the elites are doing nothing right now more than counting their money out of their safe and sitting there looking at the masses and just laughing their asses off because people are so fucking caught up in their own prejudices and hatred that they can't stop for a second and realize, wait a minute, it's those bastards up there that are divvying us all apart and making us argue with each other and fight each other. Now, I'm not saying we can't have discussions, and I'm not saying that, you know, discussion shouldn't be allowed. I encourage people of all different viewpoints to come together to discuss things, even if they're totally on other sides of the equation in terms of viewpoint or persuasion. But what humanity needs to do is to realize that everybody's different, everybody's unique, everybody has an opinion, and we need to learn to accept each other for those reasons, but at the same time, you know, be able to unite on the commonalities that we do have as humans, regardless of whatever semantical opinions or whatever else you want to put behind, you know, individualism aside, you know. If we're going to go from a society to a civilization, we need to learn to cooperate, regardless of opinions or personal views or belief systems or whatever, you know.
Being civil.
We got to be civil to one another. That's the one thing that we need to unite on is being, you know, civil towards one another, being kind.
Then there's the whole peace illusion. People think that peace is defined by everybody getting along, thinking the same, feeling the same, all doing the same thing. But that's actually utopianism, which another name for that is Nazism. Actual peace is simply no conflict, because a lack of peace is what? It's fighting, it's war, it's genocide, it's bloodshed, it's all this nasty stuff. So what is peace? It's a lack of that. It's the opposite of that. So it's simply a matter to agree that, you know, if you don't like somebody, that doesn't mean you have to go and bash their skull in for it. You know, that's what peace is.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Yeah, we need to, you know, the only way we're going to get along as a species is when we can learn to cooperate in the most loose form. I mean, yeah, there's still going to be ethnic groups. There's still going to be, you know, Earth isn't going to change, but in a way it's going to have to change, but in a loose sense, it's going to have to, people are just going to have to learn to accept each other because no matter what.
People are going to have to learn to hate without A, acting on it, and B, without narrowing their minds in the process.
Exactly. You know, and I use the term hate loosely. I mean, you know, dislike is more the proper word. You know, there's always going to be people in the world that just don't like you for whatever reason, don't want to be around you, don't want to deal with you. And that's fine. You know, I deal with people like that all the time. And to those people, I can say, fuck off. I don't care. Continue not liking me. Have fun with that. Hate me. You know, let it be a drag on you. That's fine. But, you know, humans need to get into the idea of making a difference where they can and accepting the things that, you know, they just simply can't change, you know, because some things in life you just can't change, and that's just a fact. You just got to drop the pieces where they are, accept them for what they are, understand them for what they are, know them for what they are, and deal with it that way.
But also realize that we're programmed to think that we can't change anything. So to not go by that and be like, okay, I should accept what I can't change. Well, I can't change anything. I should just accept that I'm poor little me and useless and hopeless. And no. This is not what's being said here. Because most of the things that you think you can't change, you actually can. And most of the things you think you can change, you actually can't. That there's been like a reverse flip pulled on us. We've been made suckers.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, exactly. I mean, you know, we're currently going through that slow period right now, but, you know, you didn't catch a majority of the meat of my rant earlier where I was talking about all the different, you know, forms of slavery and how it's more of a human issue than it is a race issue. But, you know, yeah, I've pretty much given my piece on this whole thing. I pretty much said my opinionatory push, as it were. I've kind of given my full 10 cents worth on this pretty much thus far. I'm just, you know, I'm at that point of where I'm like, you know, tired of hearing people, you know, bitch on and on and on about, you know, the marital status of the number 5, you know, being related to the tuna sandwich and how that's going to correlate with Tim and Joni getting married. It's like, what? Excuse me? How do these things correlate together? I don't know.
Yeah, if you really look at it objectively, it's just a big pile of poo. You look at it like, wow, that's nonsense. How did I ever once believe that that actually made any sense?
Mm-hmm.
You can't argue about the marital status of the number 5 and expect to ever hope to come to an answer. It's just, the question's fucking ridiculous. Oh, but what if you believed it's not? Oops, oh, there's the trap. That's why I like to say the facts of any matter are completely irrelevant, but understand my context on that. What I mean is that actions have consequences, and humans always take action based on their belief systems. They never take action based on logic or facts. However, in fairness, belief systems, no matter how full of shit they might be, do have a self-supporting mechanism that say, I am factual, I am logical, everything else is crap. So even if something is completely non-logical, non-factual, the belief system inherently has a mechanism that says, yes, I am logical, I am factual, everything else is crap. So if we're not willing to even look at the possibility that we might have been deceived and might be full of shit, then we are what Vinnie Eastwood explained as being the cosmic schmuck. Cosmic meaning big, schmuck meaning idiots. And, you know, if you're sitting there asking, wow, dude, you know, am I the cosmic schmuck? Then chances are you're probably not. But if you're sitting there going, there is no way I could ever be the cosmic schmuck, and chances are, yeah, you're the cosmic schmuck. Still here, Rich?
Yes, I am. Oh, I'm just currently watching this news article video thing about some poor 19-year-old beaten by, you know, yet again, back on track of, you know, really when it comes down to certain members in the black community, I can say if you want people to look at you with a little bit more of a straight face instead of looking at you suspiciously, don't be abusive, don't grab 19-year-olds out of their car, you know, shave their head while you're filming it and laughing and then saying I got my ass whooped written on their forehead out of their eyeliner and signing your name and kissing it and then slapping them and beating them around because they have a nicer car than you. See, that's monkey shit. I'm sorry, that's monkey shit. You know, that's nigger move. We had a guy at the truck stop like a week or so back who didn't have a diesel container, he needed like a gas can or something. We didn't have gas cans. We don't sell them. But anyway, he needed one. So what does he do? He basically schmoozes all the truckers. He's trying to talk them into putting fuel in a couple of oil cans or whatever, which you can't do that because they're not legally designed to hold diesel. So what does he do? He steals one of our water buckets that we use for people to wash their windshields. He steals one of those and takes off in another guy's truck with, you know, he gets a ride in another guy's truck and drives off with the bucket, you know, that he stole. But I mean, it's shit like that that just makes me sit there and just facepalm, and it's like, and you wonder why people look at you so negatively. It's because you do stupid shit like that. And same with anybody in those minority groups that do stupid crap. It's like, you wonder why people treat you like garbage. It's because, well, you put out, if you put out garbage, what do you expect to get back in return? That's kind of a biblical principle.
I think you are
what you eat. You know, if you're throwing bullshit out, you're going to get nothing but bullshit back. And this other video, this black guy beating up this 19-year-old white girl because she's got a nicer car, is just another example to me.
Another contributing factor to that is that, you know, even though it's the minority of idiots making everybody else look bad, part of the reason is because the majority of people who aren't acting like that also won't speak up. Well, it's starting to little by little more and more now, but they won't speak up. They won't stand up and speak up and say, hey, that's no, So because they're too afraid. Like, oh, I better stay quiet. I don't want to make waves. I don't want to cause trouble. That's none of my concern. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da. All these reasons to keep silent because you're afraid of being bonked on the head. And granted, if you speak up, you might get bonked on the head, but, you know, so what? Just a lesson learned. You might end up learning why you get bonked on the head and become a better person for it. But anyway, that's a part of the problem. So if the majority would speak up against the minority and say, hey, no, these idiots don't speak for us, then everybody else would not, you know, have the stereotypical prejudiced racist view. You know, there wouldn't be these stereotypes of, you know, these black niggers and these filthy rednecks and, you know, Bugs Bunny and the Nips making fun of the Japanese and whatever else you can think of. All this wouldn't be there if the majority would be willing to stand up and say, hey, see those idiots? They don't represent us. Just like the majority of Muslims are not willing to stand up and say, hey, see these ISIS idiots? These morons don't represent us. They're not willing. They're too scared. They're afraid if they say anything that ISIS is going to sneak in their fucking bedroom window and behead them. And you know what? I can't tell you that ISIS won't. But I can tell you that ISIS is not going to be stopped unless, you know, you all speak up and say something. ISIS is going to continue to terrorize you.
Yeah, exactly. And same to, you know, good black folk out there, you know, who are in rundown neighborhoods with gangs, you know, black gangs. Same to Mexicans or whites or whatever. The only way your community is going to get better is when you start taking the trash out. You know, go to the same. I'm just saying, you know, do what you need to do as a community. Take care of your problem, you know, and clean up after yourselves. You know, you've let in a better term, you've let termites infest your house. What do? You kill the termites. You knock them out. You weed them out.
Same thing on the national level. We are the, you know, basically decent but brainwashed majority who are letting an extreme minority of psychopaths rule. But like what I said earlier, what if all of a sudden we all said no? You know, we all have more people, more guns, more knowledge, more this, more that. Collectively, we are the fucking majority. So there's no violence even needed in this. If we all just looked at them and said, no, your dictates are stupid, and we're not going to listen to you anymore. What could they do other than cry, than go to the Ukraine and cry me a river, you know, haha.
Mm-hmm. Oh, look, DA's little Nazi icon turned rainbow-colored. Seriously, you can go look at it on DeviantArt. It's funny as hell. Talk about something that offends everyone.
Let's bow to the state. Let's rainbowize the partial swastika that we've used as our logo. Yay. If people want to get up in arms and ban something, ban the fucking DA logo, not the Confederate flag.
Precisely. Yeah, it looks like a swastika. God. It looks like a freaking swastika. Sieg Heil. Yeah. I mean, hell, we made the video on that whole thing.
Mm-hmm. I refuse to use the new logo and anything I
own. Oh, yeah. Yeah. No, the new logo's fucking, it looks like Hitler's dildo, and especially when it's rainbow colored like the gay pride flag.
Yeah, when you excuse me, when you look at the ending sequence for the newer pre-recorded PSEC episodes, and it's got the little icons for social media stuff on there, you'll see the DA logo is being represented by the old logo. I will not put that piece of shit swastika on there. I just won't.
Mm-hmm. Nope.
I mean, if I'm joking about Nazis, I'll put a swastika on there, obviously, but not for, like, a normal all-purpose thing the way. So, anything else you want to say on these subjects?
No, I'm pretty much tapped out. I've said everything I needed to say, you know, and to anybody who's butthurt or offended out there, it's like, well,
you have the right to be, and that's okay.
Yeah, you have the right to be, but yet again, if you are offended, it's like, well, maybe it's something to think about. So next time, you know, you come back, you know, you've kind of cleared up some of your own societal blockages and realized, hey, that is bullshit. Why am I doing that?
You know, what was that little graphic the other day? How you perceive me is a reflection of you. And how I perceive you as an awareness of me.
Oh, yeah.
That's how that went.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, totally. I think I've been doing pretty good today, actually, because, like, my body's in such retaliation. There's no part of it that doesn't hurt. My cellular structure is just screaming. I'm just thankful that I don't have a migraine on top of it. That was yesterday, but today every cell in my body is just screaming.
Mm-hmm.
I understand why. It's going, where's my garbage? You're giving me 100% nutrition. Where did my garbage go? So it's my cellular structure is like crying like a little bitch.
I want bullshit.
Yeah, same thing with drama. You know, remember what I was saying about neural peptides and you know, those chemicals matching frequencies of emotion and being released in the bloodstream and how corrosive they could be, and they're highly addictive like heroin. You know, what does a heroin addict do to get more heroin? Whatever they need to do. So if you're addicted to a drama chemical, what are you going to do to keep that chemical flowing? Create more drama, sabotage yourself, go into victimization, go into hate, go into self-righteousness and justification and all this other shit. So that corrosive, nasty chemical can keep flowing. And I'm not giving my cells what they want on this. So my cells are like, fuck you.
Yeah, exactly.
That's why whenever anybody, the paradigm shifts very, you know, very profoundly within a short period of time, there's certain neuropeptides that stop getting reproduced, and then the next morning, you know, Rich has kind of coined this as a paradigm hangover, because you're feeling the withdrawal symptoms because there were chemicals your hypothalamus was producing yesterday that it's not producing today.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the hypothalamus is a powerful machine, that's for sure.
It's got more pharmaceuticals than your local Walgreens or CVS. It's fucking crazy what that shit's got in there. It's also got the most powerful hallucinogens known on the face of the earth up in there.
Mm-hmm.
It takes a really high, extremely positive frequency to release that into your bloodstream. But if you do, that chemical is called DMT. It's more trippy than acid. When taken externally, you know, because there are external sources of it, plants and stuff, in the United States, that drug is illegal. It's used in, like, South America and stuff for shamanic practices and all that. But, yeah, I mean, if you could hit enough a high enough frequency of emotions so that energy running through your central nervous system says to the hypothalamus, hey, release the DMT. Ooh, doggy. More trippy than acid, or so I've been told. I haven't experienced it myself personally, but... Oh, and also the high you get from marijuana is also the frequency as well. If you could manage to hit that energetic frequency of emotion, then your hypothalamus would release the exact same chemicals that are used to let you feel a marijuana high. Because that's not actually the THC that you're feeling. That's your body's response to the THC that you're feeling.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah. I love fucking science, as the Facebook page says.
Yep, I fucking love science. Yep, it is. Yeah.
And not that Darwinian William Black ain't a retentive science. It's like, no, shut up. I mean the real science.
Shut up. My friend's a G+ said I'm right. You're full of shit.
Yep. So I guess that's it. I guess you pretty much covered everything.
Yeah, I pretty much let out everything I needed to really say. I haven't posted any InfoWars articles, you know, if there's anybody out there that watches my DA page. I haven't been posting anything lately because I'm just not, you know, I don't feel there's anything really that I need to say besides what I've already said about Jade Helm, you know.
Yeah.
That's kind of the important issue right now. We need to be focusing on what the psychopaths are doing, not what, you know, some piece of cloth in the South did to inspire some wackadoo to use a tool to harm a bunch of people.
Yeah. Totally.
I'm just, you know, I feel like
worrying about the milk you spilled on the kitchen floor while the lion's about to eat you.
Yeah, exactly.
It's like, what? Doesn't make much sense.
And if Rochelle's listening, I mean, she could totally be a part of this conversation and add some really good contributions, maybe display some of her cool nail art or do something like that. But oh no, that's just not cool enough. Not enough contributation. It's just horrible, awful. No, can't do it.
Yeah, she's having some self-worth paradigm issues right now, but it's all good. We're respecting her pace because in order for her to give herself the right to say yes, she's got to give herself the right to say no.
Exactly.
And so it's about stepping off the hamster wheel, that emotional spiral, and just stepping off the thing completely and going, all right, you know, let's look at what's going on here.
Mm-hmm.
We already, you know, explained the elephant in the room earlier, so.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe next time she'll join us. Maybe she'll see that this is a fun conversation, and, you know, maybe she'll join us next time. Who knows?
It's a possibility.
Yep.
Very much a possibility.
Totally is.
Oh, man, what's the temperature outside right now? It's supposed to be that, you know.
Over here, it's 64 degrees Fahrenheit.
Oh, you're a lucky son of a gun. Got that lake effect going. Yeah, it's a good old hot 104 degrees Fahrenheit, 102 just down the street in Crestview.
Fun.
Nice. Hot 105 in Phoenix, 105 in Central Point. Yeah, I can feel it. It's warm.
Fun shit. Oh, look. Mm-hmm. Y'all just replied to something or another on Facebook. Where is that? I just saw it pop up in a status. Anyway. I guess we should probably end this now. So, everybody, hope you've enjoyed it. And if you haven't, oh well. And catch y'all later.
Yep. Have a good evening.